Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev. I teach digital media in the University of Wollongong in Australia, and today I'm presenting a paper titled Object Chirophanies and the Mode of Anticipation. This is a paper to be presented at ICEA Hong Kong 2016 as part of a panel entitled Data Natures, the Politics and Aesthetics of Prediction. The Internet of Things as a phenomenon stands for the connection of a wide array of material objects to the Internet, ranging from everyday trivia such as plants and household objects to all sorts of critical infrastructure. At the very least, this connectivity allows things to broadcast sensory data remotely, in the process augmenting material settings with ambient data capture and processing capabilities. Russell Davies famously quipped that, "I can't understand why teddy bears did not have Wi-Fi before. A bear without Wi-Fi is barely alive, a semi-bear. A bear with Wi-Fi, on the other hand, is alive on the Internet of Things. Once connected, each thing acquires a network address, making it uniquely identifiable. The object usually has some sort of layered sensing capacity, allowing it to dynamically register changes to its environment and transmit that information over the internet. In most cases, it's also able to store and process that information, as well as independently initiate an interaction with its surroundings. Due to its constant connectivity, the thing is remotely localizable within its environment, and it may be provided with a semantic interface legible to humans." In the Internet of Things jargon, every object equipped with the above capabilities is said to become context-aware, where context is understood as the triad of location, identity, state. An object has a unique identity and is capable of dynamically engaging with and registering changes to its location and state. Completing the picture, the context data produced in the process is by definition transmitted to and indexed in a remote database, from the perspective of which the contextual data is the object. The Internet of Things, therefore, involves physical objects monitoring their immediate environments through a variety of sensors, transmitting the acquired data to remote databases for processing or storage, and initiating actions based on embedded algorithms and feedback loops. The aptly named Amazon Echo, released into the world in late June 2015, is just such an object. The Echo is a roughly 25 cm high black cylinder containing a microphone, speaker, processor, storage space, and hardware for internet connectivity. The Echo continuously listens to all speech in its surroundings and reacts to the wake word Alexa. It engages with its interlocutors through a female-sounding interface called the Alexa Voice Service. The Alexa Voice Service, in turn, listens to all ambient sounds in its surroundings, interpreting its name, Alexa, as the start of a query. The data from each query is sent to the Amazon Web Services cloud for processing and returns vocalized by Alexa's algorithm within an average latency of 1.5 seconds.
When it first arrived from Amazon, I didn't know what it was. What is it?
You'll see.
Is it for me?
It's for everyone. It's called Amazon Echo.
How's it going?
I'm just finishing up right now.
Is it on?
Oh, it's always on.
Can it hear me right now?
Nope. It only hears you when you use the wake word we chose. Alexa.
Well, what does it do?
Alexa, what do you do?
I can play music, answer questions, get the news and weather, create to-do lists, and much more.
Awesome. Alexa, play rock music.
Rock music.
Alexa, stop.
Wait, I want to try.
Alexa, what time is it?
The time is 3:27.
You actually don't have to yell at it. Oh. Okay, it uses far-field technology, so it can hear you from anywhere in the room.
So it can just hear you anywhere?
Yes. Well, everyone can hear you anyway.
Oh, is that where we're going to put it?
I was thinking of putting it there, but it works anywhere.
At Echo is pretty neat because it knows all sorts of things. All you have to do is ask.
Alexa, how tall is Mount Everest?
Mount Everest's height is 29,029 feet, 8,848 meters.
How can it know so much? It's so small.
Well, it updates using the cloud. That's also how it gets its answers.
Just read that off the box, huh?
Dad really likes that Echo just plugs in, so we never have to charge it. Plus, Echo's really good at keeping track of things like shopping and to-do lists.
Paper. Alexa, add wrapping paper to the shopping list.
I've put wrapping paper on your shopping list.
Alexa, how many teaspoons are in a tablespoon?
1 tablespoon equals 3 teaspoons.
Okay. Alexa, set a timer for 8 minutes.
8 minutes, starting now.
Dad's not a morning person, but Echo definitely helps him wake up.
Alexa, alarm off.
You gotta get up.
Oh, it's Saturday.
Alexa, what day is it?
Today is Thursday, November 13th.
I'm up. Alexa, give me my flash news briefing.
Here's your flash briefing.
From NPR News in Washington, I'm Lakshmi Singh.
What did the dog say after a long day of work?
What?
Today was rough. Get it?
Yeah, I get it.
Another one.
Alexa, tell me another joke.
I wondered why the baseball was getting bigger, and then it hit me.
Sometimes Echo helps out when you least expect it.
Hey, Dad, how do you spell cantaloupe?
Cantaloupe. C-A-N-T... Alexa, how do you spell cantaloupe?
Cantaloupe is spelled C-A-N-T-A-L-O-U-P-E.
Good job.
Echo loves to play music and knows a lot of songs, and they always sound great.
Alexa, play my dance mix.
The playlist dance.
Alexa, stop. Alexa, define annoying.
The term annoying means one, causing irritation or annoyance.
Example, my brother.
And with the companion app, you can access Echo from anywhere. With everything Echo can do, it's really become part of the family.
To experience Echo, go to amazon.com/echo.
The data in these query loops makes its journey to the obfuscated proprietary taxonomy of the Amazon Web Services farm and returns to the situated object as a transcendental revealing of an opaque order impenetrable to human interlocutors. Agency, translated as data, is transported to the transcendental realm of the Amazon Web Services, where it is modulated, stored for future reference, and returned as an answering echo. In effect, an Internet of Things-enabled object appears as the receptacle of an exterior force that differentiates it from its milieu and gives it meaning and value in unpredictable ways, precisely because it is first and foremost a data echo. Objects such as the echo acquire their value, and in so doing become real for their interlocutors, only insofar as they participate in one way or another in remote data realities transcending the locale of the object. In their analysis of location-aware smart environments, Sally Aplin and Michael Fisher argue that agency is fundamentally the capacity to make and execute non-deterministic choices intended to advance to a goal as events unfold. For example, humans exercise agency when deciding whether to turn on a light or to walk across a street to avoid a possible obstacle. Agency implies that agents' future choices are not intrinsically fixed or stochastically predictable, except on the basis of secondary principles of reasoning, such as rationality, cooperation, or enmity. The foundation of a social relationship requires a mutual presumption of agency on the part of the other. Social relations require that each party assumes the other has some level of agency. Insofar as the data gleaned by such devices has predictive potential when viewed in aggregate, the enactment of this potential in a local setting is always already a singular act of manifestation of a transcendental data nature with an overriding level of agency, which is not stochastic from the perspective of its human user. In his work on non-modern notions of sacred space, philosopher of religion Mircea Eliade conceptualized this active manifestation of another modality of being into a local setting as a hierophany. Hierophanies are not continuous, but wholly singular acts of presence by a different modality of being. By manifesting that modality, which Eliade termed as the sacred, an object becomes the receptacle for transcendental presence, yet simultaneously continues to remain inextricably entangled in its surrounding milieu. Eliade argued that in a hierophantic setting, objects or acts acquire a value and in so doing become real because they participate after one way or another in a reality that transcends them. Among countless stones, one stone becomes sacred and hence instantly becomes saturated with being because it constitutes a hierophany. The object appears as the receptacle of an exterior force that differentiates it from its milieu and gives it meaning and value. Spaces punctured by hierophanies are not homogeneous, but are experienced as heterogeneous array of interruptions, crevices, liminal breaks, folds, and pulses of enchantment. In other words, the manifestation of a hierophantic presence reconstitutes heretofore homogeneous spaces. By manifesting the sacred, every object becomes something else, yet it continues to remain itself, for it continues to participate in its surrounding milieu. A hierophany can also act as an anchor for the surrounding space, adding a layer, a hierophantic layer, to a space reframes it as the locus for another mode of reality, another mode of being. In fact, there is a strange similarity between non-modern imaginaries of hierophany as a gateway to the sacred and Internet of Things enabled objects transducing lossy into liminal and opaque data taxonomies looping back as a black box echo. The echo, through the voice of Alexa, is in effect the hierophantic articulator of a wholly non-human modality of being. When viewed in aggregate, such hierophany punctured spaces seem to resonate in a mode of anticipation. Recently, Sally Aplin and Michael Fisher have argued that when aggregated within a particular material setting, Internet of Things enabled objects form what is in effect an anticipatory materiality acting as a host to human interlocutors. Physical spaces are gradually shifting with the aid of pervasive technology from being mainly locations or destinations with space in between towards the notion of being places that host transitions. The material setting becomes anticipatory because of the implied sociability of its component objects, allowing them to not only exchange data about their human interlocutor, but also draw on remote data resources and then actuate based on the parameters of that aggregate social memory. Aplin and Fisher argue that an environment, to be truly smart, must learn from the cumulative data within its realm to understand and guess what likely choices might be for a given agent and then facilitate or enact these on behalf of that agent. In effect, humans and other objects are rendered within a flat ontology of anticipation, waiting for the data echo to return. The mode of anticipation reveals itself in two vectors, the reification of materiality and the human, by extension, as data, mirrored by the animation of the mechanical as the echo of that data. The resulting materiality is literally on demand, in that it exists as relational data first and foremost, and physical agency only when demanded. Yet it is also anticipatory in that the main characteristic of connected objects is their capacity to initiate action based on predictive data natures. Thank you for listening, and I look forward to fielding your questions preferably through Twitter.